Different strength training exercises have different force vectors. A force vector is simply the direction in which force is being produced relative to the body. So force vectors can either be vertical, they can be horizontal, can be lateral, or they can be rotational. Long-term training programs with exercises that have different force vectors have been shown to produce different results, both in terms of strength gains and also in terms of transfer to sporting movement. And we think this happens for three reasons. Firstly, because there is joint angle specificity in the strength gains that each exercise involves. Secondly, because the different exercises with different force vectors train different muscles. And thirdly, because the posture differs between exercises with different force vectors. Research has compared the long-term effects of exercises with a range of different force vectors, vertical, horizontal, lateral and rotational. But the force vectors that are most interesting for strength coaches tend to be the vertical and horizontal force vectors, because vertical force vector is the one that is used in the vertical jump. And the horizontal force vector is the one that is used during running and sprinting. And the two most common exercises that have been used to test the force vector specificity of exercises are the squat and the hip thrust, because the squat has a very obvious vertical force vector and the hip thrust has a horizontal force vector. The squat and the hip thrust are both hip extension movements. They both improve the ability to produce a hip extension turning force or torque after training. However, since they have different force vectors, they produce slightly different results. And if we analyse the differences in the two exercises, we can see how this happens. The squat has a vertical force vector, and that means that we move the load approximately in parallel with the spine throughout the movement. And the squat has several features that are important for us to understand if we want to appreciate why it produces the results that it does. And the most important feature of the squat is the way in which its external moment arm lengths change throughout the exercise range of motion. So at the very top of the movement, the external moment arm lengths of the barbell on our joints are very short. And that means that we have to exert a relatively low muscle force to keep the barbell upright. And when we descend into the squat, our joints, our key joints, the hip and the knee, move further and further and further away from the barbell. And this means that the barbell has far greater leverage on them, which means that the amount of force they have to produce to lift the barbell back up again becomes greater. And this means that the squat exercise is hardest when we are in the bottom position, when our muscles are at their longest lengths, and it is easiest at the top when the muscles are at their shortest lengths. Using the squat to develop hip extension strength therefore has quite strong joint angle specific effects. It preferentially improves our ability to produce force when the muscles are at longer lengths compared to when they're at shorter lengths. But the way in which external moment arm lengths change during the squat range of motion don't just affect the training adaptations on each individual muscle. They also affect which muscle is developed most effectively. When we produce a hip extension turning force when the hip is very flexed, a large proportion of that force comes from the adductor magnus, and lesser proportions of the force come from the hamstrings and the gluteus maximus. And this ratio changes as we extend the hip more and more. So as the hip is more extended, a much greater proportion of the hip extension turning force comes from the gluteus maximus, and much less comes from the adductor magnus. So the squat tends to develop the adductor magnus to a much greater extent than the gluteus maximus. The hip thrust involves a horizontal force vector. Although we are still lifting the barbell vertically, our body is positioned horizontally. We're lying down facing upwards, and therefore the force vector is horizontal. We're moving the barbell away from our body forwards. And if we look at the hip thrust, we can understand how this force vector affects the various different strength adaptations that happen after training. In the hip thrust, the external moment arm length of the barbell on the hip doesn't change that much throughout the exercise range of motion, and it's still relatively long at the top of the movement. And these features of the external moment arm length are obviously very different from those in the squat. So in the hip thrust, the joint angle specific strength gains that we observe in each muscle after strength training are not anywhere near as pronounced as they are in the squat. And also, the gluteus maximus is trained to a much greater extent because it has its greatest leverage at the top of the movement when the hip is extended. The hip thrust and the squat also differ in respect of the body position during the exercise. And in the squat, we're obviously standing upright. In the hip thrust, we're lying on our back. And some research indicates that performing exactly the same joint angle movement in a standing or a lying facing down or a lying facing up position can produce different amounts of force. Whether training in each position leads to specific strength gains in that position is somewhat unclear, and the mechanisms that underlie these different levels of force production are also unclear. It's been suggested that they might be related to postural reflexes or sympathetic nervous system activity or a range of other factors, but the fact is at the moment that we don't know exactly why this happens and whether it could contribute to the transfer of strength from an exercise to a different exercise after training, or indeed to the actual specificity of force production in that exercise itself. In summary, strength training with an exercise that involves a specific joint angle movement, like hip extension, is specific to the force vector used in training. And this specificity seems to occur partly because of joint angle specific strength gains and partly because of the muscle group that's emphasized most during training. And it may also occur as a result of the precise posture used in the exercise.